Hello, everyone, and welcome to Fast Charge, the weekly podcast from the team at Tech Advisor. We are here on episode 101. Boring and unexciting episode, because now there's at least 99 episodes to go before I can be excited about fun milestones again. So there's now just this like dreary slog for the best part of 2 years as we move towards episode 200.
I've lost all enthusiasm
for this. Yeah, no, I'm out of this. I'm bored. I'm mentally checked out already.
Done.
Luckily, the rest of you aren't. So I'm joined this week by Lewis and Toddy, our two regulars. And Aniran has popped up this week as well, because he's going to help run through everything to do with the Galaxy Tab S8. So yeah, not to give away half of what we're talking about today, but we are going to be talking the Galaxy S22 series and the Galaxy Tab S8 series. We're just doing a little Samsung special because, well, when Samsung holds a Galaxy Unpacked event to launch its flagship phones, no one else tends to announce anything else that week, because they kind of see which way the wind is blowing. You see the same thing in an Apple launch week. So yeah, this was Samsung's week, and we will duly give them the attention they deserve, or at least that they want. So we're going to be focusing on all things Samsung once we get into the meat of this episode. Before that, though, there are a few other bits of news to round through, as always. I'm going to start with what's going on next week. And this, if nothing else, should be the surest sign that people, tech companies, have consciously left this week clear because it's the Samsung week. Because next week, we now know that in China, there's going to be the launch of the Xiaomi Redmi K50 Gaming Edition. Maybe the other K50s, but we're not sure. They're just promising the Gaming Edition. That's on the 16th of February in China. That is also, I think the K50s are the phones that are probably going to become the Poco F4s, if I got my numbering right.
That sounds right.
So this is maybe interesting, just because if you are interested in the Poco F4 line, the K50 Gaming Edition is probably going to be a Poco F4 Pro or something like that when it comes to the West. So that's on the 16th. That's Wednesday, I think. Same day, we have the Realme 9 series, or the Realme 9 Pro series at least, launching in Europe and India, also on the 16th. Thursday the 17th, we're now confirmed to have the Nubia Red Magic 7. So that's more gaming phones. They're going to be pretty high-end, Snapdragon 8 Gen 1, 165-watt charging in at least one of them, that's confirmed. Wow. And the same day, the Thursday 17th, we're also going to have the launch of, and I hate that this is the fourth news section in the row where I've talked about OnePlus products, but we're going to have the launch of the OnePlus Nord CE2. That is now confirmed to be February 17th, next Thursday. And we also have a couple officially confirmed specs, which are 65-watt charging, which, isn't crazy, but for what is presumably a fairly cheap phone, pretty good. And also, they revealed it has a headphone jack, which is always nice to see. And again, not so crazy for a cheaper phone. But yeah, in a two-day span next week, we have at least one K50, two Realme 9 models, one OnePlus, and at least two Red Magic 7 phones.
And a partridge in a pear tree.
Exactly. And that's just the stuff we know is coming over a two-day spread next week. I bet you someone else has another phone ready to go that they just haven't told us about yet.
There must be a Motorola around the corner somewhere. There's got to be.
There's always a Motorola around the corner.
So geez. On the 20-something, there's the launch of the Edge X30 or whatever X30, that's confirmed. Yeah. That's later this month. Obviously, that's before we even get to the MWC stuff. That's right at the end of the month. So what we're seeing is this strange thing where a lot of brands have clearly decided they're not launching at MWC, because that starts right at the end of the month, that sort of February 28th period. They don't want to do that, but equally the new Samsung had parked down on February 9th, and so they've stayed clear of that. So we've got this crunch now between Samsung and MWC, where a lot of brands seem to have a lot of phones ready to throw out into the world. It does look a little bit like everyone thought, we won't announce at MWC, everyone announces at MWC, and physical events are so passe anyway. We'll get more press coverage if we announce on our own the week before MWC. The problem is, every brand has had the exact same thought. Yes. So instead, we've got a crunch in the 1 or 2 week period leading up to the trade show. And I'm very worried we're going to get to MWC and there's going to be like one phone left to launch, because we're running out of phones at this point. Anyway, so next week's going to be busy. What else? Other bits from this week. Google pushed out another update to the Pixel 6, which is at least the second update that has just broken Pixel 6s. I don't know what is going on over there. It's embarrassing. So this one breaks Wi-Fi for a lot of Pixel 6 and 6 Pros. It just means Wi-Fi doesn't work anymore. Some people have even said that it simultaneously breaks Wi-Fi and Bluetooth on their devices, which is
of all the companies to mess up software updates.
Literally.
I know. How? And on the Pixels, you know, this is meant to be part of the key strength of the Pixel is you get these exclusive updates, you get early updates, you get, you know, custom tweaked software. Maybe they can't nail that. Yeah. What's the sell of a Pixel?
Maybe designing your own custom silicon is hard to develop for.
And yes, and that may be part of the problem, right?
Imagine that. The
first phones where they're not just relying on all the stuff, because Qualcomm does back-end work on firmware and stuff like that, but, you know, we don't talk about it. It's not the sexy side of the chip stuff, but
what is
there.
The sexy side of the chip stuff?
Oh, gigahertz, Tolly.
It's gigahertz. All about those gigahertz.
Clock speeds, man. all right, so Google just broke a load of Pixel 6s for the hell of it. Apple has decided that instead of selling phones, it's going to sell like payment terminals, just, you know, for funsies. So iPhones are now going to be able to serve as payment terminals from later this year, US only, but, you know, that just means it will roll out everywhere else eventually. But basically Apple is just looking at another pre-existing industry it can kill in one fell swoop and say, why buy a dedicated like contactless payment terminal when you can just buy a cheap iPhone and that will do the same thing.
I mean, I feel like Apple is single-handedly bringing up how transactions are made in the US, because they were like, even now, I think card and the mag strip is like still very much a thing over there.
Contactless basically NFC only exists because of Apple Pay.
Yeah,
in the States,
pretty much, which is crazy.
Yeah, still very strange. So this is the next step of that. It sort of makes some sense, and you know, we've obviously seen loads of business use of tablets and stuff to serve these like payment terminals and stuff like that. So it's a kind of natural next step to just be like, you can do NFC contact between two phones and that will do a payment and it won't be iPhone only and stuff like that. But it is an interesting little move from them. Honor have unveiled the Honor 60 SE. We've already had some Honor 60s, but this is a new one in the lineup. It's a Chinese only launch for now. I'm not sure if it'll come out anywhere else. It's a mid-range phone. It's not crazy exciting. Dimensity 900 chipset, 66-watt charging, 64-megapixel camera. But it's that camera that kind of caught my attention because, just if you're listening to this or if you're watching, just open a tab and Google Honor 60 SE and, you know, have a little think about what existing phone that camera module reminds you of. It's a certain Californian company. They're quite popular. They're launching new payment terminals, from what I've heard. The Honor 60 SE looks a lot like the Pro iPhones. That triple camera in the sort of triangle arrow formation is specific, singular, immediately recognizable, maybe. Yeah. Things like that. So, you know, I like Honor, I really do, but man, this is blatant.
Cheeky.
This is really blatant. And last thing to round through is Oppo. This week, might be the end of last week, but within the last 7 days, Oppo gave the Reno 7 series its first global launch. We had it in China already. Reno 7 has now launched in India, though, which may well be the start of it spilling out more widely globally. We've talked about this on the show before, it's always complicated with the Renos though, because the Find X series tend to just grab a couple Reno models and rebrand them. So for example, we're expecting the Oppo Find X5 series soonish. We kind of think probably the Find X5 Neo or Lite models may well just be rebranded Reno 7s. So the Reno 7s may not launch further. It gets confusing though, because those Oppos will, the Find X's will launch in India where the Renos have also launched. So you don't know exactly what they're going to do. And as always, there's complications like what they've launched in India is the Reno 7 and the Reno 7 Pro. The Reno 7 Pro is the same as the Chinese Reno 7 Pro, but the Indian Reno 7 is not the same as the Chinese Reno 7.
Of
it has a different chipset. It has different charging speeds. And it's actually not even quite the same size. I can't remember which way around, but one of them is a little thinner and lighter.
I think the Indian one is thinner.
That was my thought as well, but I didn't want to.
It's what, either a 6-watt charging difference or something like that?
It's one is 60 and one is 65 or something.
Yeah.
I think China is 60 and India is 65. It's all very odd little tweaks. So they're very, very similar phones, the two Reno 7s, but they are not technically the same. And the thickness is a funny one because it means it's a different chassis. Like from a manufacturing perspective,
is that
there are different
their market research is so precise that they can tell what tweaks they need to make the 7 more successful in India is like a few 0.1 mil difference to the chassis.
Yeah, I don't know.
And 6 watts extra charging speed, and then it's like a better phone for that market. Like, it seems so unnecessary.
I'd love to pick the brains of someone who makes these kinds of decisions, especially because it's almost always India that gets these versions that are the same name as another market, but not different. India always feels like the odd one out, the one that really has just a unique version of a phone with a unique name, for some strange reason that I don't know if it's incredibly specific market research telling them exactly what works in the Indian market versus Europe versus China, or if it's blunt stuff about manufacturing facilities in different countries or availability of components for different countries or different timelines and that kind of thing, and that shifts. But yeah, it gets a little bit complicated. But yeah, Reno 7's beginning to roll out. They may launch more widely than this. It may be that we just sometime soon see Find X5s that are really Renos. And who knows what India and China get now that they have Renos. So I don't know. Cool, let's turn to Samsung. So Samsung announced 6 products this week. We had a Galaxy Unpacked event where they launched the new Galaxy S22 series and the Tab S8 series. We're going to talk about all of them. We're going to start with the phones, and then we're going to move to the tablets. So each of these series is kind of funny because there is a common thread in how they're structured, which is a regular model and a plus model that are, I think the best word is maybe conservative. They are safe upgrades that take the previous gen model, tweak them, upgrade the chipset, camera's a little bit better, maybe the charging's a bit faster, things like that. But they're basically kind of, you know that thing you liked? We improved it a little bit. Here's some more of it.
As much as Google wishes the Pixel line was the default Android phone, the Galaxy S base and like one are the default Android phone.
If anything, weirdly, I'd say the Plus model is, because that's the closer one that's almost like a template everyone else uses, because they all go for that Plus size, right?
True.
Whereas weirdly, the base S21 is one of the few smallish Android phones out there.
Yeah,
no one else makes them that size. Anyway, so relatively conservative base models for both the S and the Tab S series, but both of them have weird ultra models. Which are either doing that they're different to the other models, you know, like different designs, kind of striking physical changes. They're both doing something weird. One of them is doing something very new. One of them is, if anything, doing the opposite. And it's a very backwards looking product, not necessarily in a bad way, but it's consciously looking at what Samsung have done before. So the ultras are these odd ones. So I'm going to start with the boring ones and we'll move on. But yeah, let's start with the S22 and the S22 Plus, which, like I said, don't change an enormous amount from the S21s. And if you looked at them at a glance, you'd probably think they were in the same lineup. The design has functionally not changed. There's little tweaks. I think the front bezel is, you know, 0.1 millimeter thinner. The dimensions have changed a little bit. But broadly to look at, these are basically the same. And you know what? I like that because I think that aesthetic they have for those phones that we also saw in the S21 FE recently, I think it's really solid. I really like that camera module they've got, that I think it's the contour cut, I think they call it, or something like that. I love that design. Very happy to see them stick with it. Basically, what they've changed, correct me if I'm wrong, Toddy, also if you disagree, I think fundamentally the important changes are 3 things. One is the one you're going to get every year, which is the chipset's been upgraded. You know, it's the new gen Exynos and Snapdragon. 2 is the cameras have changed. And in fairness to them, these are fairly substantial camera changes they've made on the base models. And the 3rd one is just they've gone back to glass. And that plastic build that they've had for 2 years, they've finally gotten rid of. They finally acknowledged that these are the flagships. People kind of expect them to be glass. Maybe everyone makes too much of a fuss about that. I think we've all made that point before, that plastic's fine and people stress about it too much. But people do stress about it. People want glass. People want the premium feel when they're spending that much. So I look at it and I can't think of anything else outside of those 3 things that's really different to last year's phone, at least not big changes.
No, nothing notable. The Plus, like last year, gets a few extra bonus bits of hardware over the standard model, but like that's it.
So yeah, the Plus changes, just because it is pretty quick to run through what's different between them. The Plus is obviously a bit larger. The S22 has a 6.1-inch display. The Plus has a 6.6-inch display. Technically, those are both ever so slightly smaller than last year's. But I think it kind of balances out. But they're about the same size. You'd struggle to tell. So the Plus is bigger, obviously. Bigger phone means bigger battery. It's got 4,500 milliamp hour, which I think is the same as it had last year. But it's 3,700 for the S22, which is actually smaller than last year's. So there's a bigger battery gap between the two phones this year. It's a pretty sizable gap there. Charging speeds are different too. 25 watts on the S22, 45 on the Plus, which again, I think is an upgrade for the Plus compared to last year, but the base model is essentially unchanged. And then the other like nitty gritty connectivity stuff is the S22 Plus. This is really an odd specific change. The S22 Plus supports Wi-Fi 6E, as does the Ultra, but the S22 only has Wi-Fi 6. So I don't know. I mean, if you even have a Wi-Fi 6E like router or modem that can handle this, this might matter.
You've already invested in a 6E router.
This does not matter to 99.99% of people, but you know, if you're really a nerd for Wi-Fi standards, the Plus.
I think it's not even available in all markets yet. It's still being certified in some markets. Like that's how new this is. Yeah,
this does not matter to almost anyone, but it's there. And the other thing is that the Plus model supports ultra wideband, which is that Smart Tag Plus, Apple AirTag tech, which is still not in the base S22. Are any of those, do you think, enough to justify what's basically a $200 price jump from the regular to the Plus? Because to me, I look at it and I know they've done it before, but I still every time look at the Plus and think the price gap is just too big between those two models to justify it.
I mean, I'm one of those journalists. I feel like journalists in particular have soft spot for small, powerful phones. So I'm almost always going to side with the smaller model there, even though you get the extras. So yeah, I don't ever find the Plus is worth it for the hike, whatever the hike is, pretty much. I don't love the size versus price comparison when the smaller phone still has so much. So yeah, for me, that's where my allegiances lie with the base S22, I think, in this particular pairing.
I mean, I think I would pay more for battery life. That's one thing I'd be like, yeah, I want the extra battery. And I mean, the charging's nice because of that, but...
For me, it's the battery, but it is also the charging, to be fair, because... I mean, Lewis, I know you're coming from an iPhone, so I don't know. You're used to sort of rubbing two sticks together and hoping the battery gets better. But
it's the wheel.
25 watts is slow, and 45 is not, you know, the fastest around, but 45 is decent. And that's a pretty big jump, actually, 25 to 45. So I'm too used now to not plugging my phone in every night, instead just plugging it in when I notice it's a bit low, leaving it for half an hour and coming back. And I think the 25 watts will bother me a little bit. Because, for example... Z Flip 3, got to get the mention in. I love that phone, but it's 15 watt charging or something. It's torturous. You know, I have different battery behavior when I use that phone because I have to charge it overnight, or I have to sit it on a wireless charger and kind of leave it there for hours next to me on a wireless charger. Because otherwise I can't plug it in for 20 minutes. That only gets me 10% back or something, you know, it's hopeless.
The Pixel 6 Pro has a huge battery. So that in and of itself is great. And Google got a lot of flack for having relatively slow charging. I forget what it is. It's like 23 or 26 watts.
It's below 30, but they give you a 30 watt.
But the battery life, they basically said, you know, we went for it. You either get fast charging and then a shorter like battery health, degrades quicker over time, or you get just better longevity over time. So it just keeps that charge longer over after like a year's worth of use. And with the Pixel, that's the first phone I'm like, okay, I'm happy to go on that side. Otherwise, like having just reviewed the Huawei P50 Pro with 66 watt wired charging, love wired charging. I think Samsung's, I think Samsung's pretty good with their wired charging, even though it sounds bad. I remember testing, I think it was last year's S21 series, their 25 watt using their official charger seemed to be more efficient than using a PD charger, which is like similar wattage or something. So
I mean, it's worth saying,
behind the curve, but it's good 25 watt charging.
Yeah, not all wattages are created equal when it comes to phone charging. There are different levels of efficiency and stuff like that. So not every 25 watt phone charges at the same speed. I'll say for me, I generally feel like kind of the sweet spot is around like 60 watt-ish, stuff that's around 60, 65 watt. Okay. I don't feel like I need faster charging than that. You know, I love that 90 watt, 100 watt. We mentioned the Red Magic 7. I think it's the Red Magic 7 Pro has been teased to have 165 watt. that's mad. That's amazing. I'd be a bit technologically scared. I'm excited by it, but I don't need that in my life. I don't need it to charge to 110 minutes, but kind of 100 and a half an hour. Yeah, cool. That's
the power adapter better come with a heat sink. Like,
yeah, exactly.
To make sure that's safe. Because that's out of nuts.
Plug it in and take a few steps back the first time. Because
this is Samsung reintroducing 45 watt charging. Not obviously to the Plus, but they've had it in the S series before.
And then it went away.
Then it went away.
I think the 20 Ultra had 45, and then the 21 Ultra dropped back down.
That feels right, yeah.
And now they're back up to 45 in the Plus and the Ultra. It's interesting you mentioned longevity, Toddy, because that is one of the other interesting changes they have introduced this year, which runs across the S22 line and actually backwards looking to some of their other products. But Samsung has actually used this as an excuse to upgrade its software promise. And we moan about software update promises all the time. But with the new S22 series, they've now said, and the wording here is careful, this got really widely reported, it's not quite what they said. What Samsung has promised, and it's a weird promise because of the phrasing, is that the S22 series will get up to 4 years of Android version updates. But up to is doing a lot of work there, because one Android version update is up to four. So they haven't promised four, they've promised maybe four, and definitely no more than four.
We'll see how we feel.
I think that means they will give them four. But if you've seen the reports being like, Samsung's doing promise 4 years, like technically no.
They've got wiggle room. If they're like, actually, this is hard. Don't worry about it.
Yeah.
Forget we said anyway, anything.
Maybe four Android version updates and a fifth. And then they did say, and a fifth year of security updates.
Which
but
is amazing.
If they deliver that, they that's deliver. More than Google promises. Yeah. And that means Samsung is the best of the Android side of the equation in terms of software promise. And I mean Apple doesn't really make promises. I don't think it has a set number of years it guarantees, but that is getting to around the sort of time Apple tends to
do. At the moment it's 4 or 5 years. It's 6 years because it's the 6S, which was 2015,
which is nice. Which is it's crazy. Always a nice surprise though, like when I see it, like, I was like, damn, Apple, you guys nailed it.
Okay, that's even better. I always forget how good Apple is. I was like, it's like 5 years, it's really good. No, it's six, it's amazing.
But pair that with the battery thing, like, then if they are expecting me to keep a phone for 4 years, say, and it still be relevant software wise then I'd probably go for the slower charging battery if it means the battery's lifespan
last a long time.
So
especially in the smaller one, in the S22, where it's only a 3700 milliamp hour battery. That's not enormous. We don't know what kind of battery life you'll get from that, but throw in degradation and that, there's a risk that would not be a full day phone before too long. So maybe the slower charging on that is a good trade-off. But yeah, so the Samsung update promise, I think that's a good step forward. It's interesting, Samsung, I'm really curious internally what the thinking from them was, because they were already, other than Google, the Android market leader on this. They weren't under pressure from Xiaomi, from Oppo, from companies like that to improve it. It was only Google that was around the same level they were. So I'm really intrigued by why they decided to say, you know what, we're already winning this, but we can win by even more than we were before. But I'm glad they've made that choice. I hope it pushes more companies to follow up. And they have extended it. It's not just the S22. It's the Tab S8 as well, which obviously we're going to talk about later. But they've also extended it backwards a little to all of the S21s, including the FE, and the Z Fold and Z Flip 3. So basically last year's flagship phones. That's really great. It also slightly nullifies when we were having the discussion with the S21 FE about how it gets an extra year of software support compared to the other S21s. And that is still true, but now it's, you know, 4 years versus 3 years, because the S21's already had its first year of that, rather than 3 years versus 2 years, which the difference is less important now. You're less likely to actually keep your phone that long. It's a smaller group of people that will run past the final update of an S21 if they went and bought one today. So it is perversely another nail in the coffin for the S21 FE, a phone that looks less and less sensible to buy by the minute. It's only in the UK, it's £70 cheaper than the base S22. I think in the States it's a $100 gap for a phone that's got an older chip and a worse camera and is made of plastic. And I don't know, just missing another few key features. And
888 Plus? Or an 888?
888, standard 888.
Standard, right. Well, then, yeah.
Yeah, yeah, that's not
so,
yeah.
I assume the smaller battery in the S21, Samsung's betting big on the improved power efficiency of the new 4-nanometer chips that they're using.
Yes, they must be. And that's worth saying. So it's strange, Samsung having always having to skirt around the chips it uses. And so in its sort of announcement video, it just talked about using our latest 4-nanometer chipset, which is a fascinating piece of phrasing because they use two different chips. They're both 4-nanometer, but only one of them is theirs. So
every
it
year.
Comes with every, and this is always the case. This isn't new. I just wish they'd just say, we're using the HN1 and the Exynos 2200 and just be open about it, but whatever. Especially when they're going to do a 5-minute deep dive on thermals, but they don't think their audience can handle a discussion of chipset names.
Do we feel like this is a particularly weird Samsung launch? It felt very in the weeds with the specs and stuff, like more than usual.
I find it really weird of all the things to deep dive on, thermals. Like, why thermals? Especially in the year you've made a big flashy return to using a glass body. Give me 5 minutes on the glass, man. Tell me about how you picked that finish and how durable it is. And you got this special Gorilla Glass Victus Plus that's a Samsung exclusive. You know, show me engineers looking at different shape, you know, pieces of glass in the light and trying to, you know, pick exactly. between them minutes. Or something. Yeah.
Yeah. I can't remember which year it was or which device it was, but there was one of those kind of like dives on design for one of their flagships 1 year. And they cut to this room in Samsung HQ. And
I remember this.
One guy. And he has a wall of swatches, different plastics and colors and different finishes. And he's like tapping them and like holding them to the light. I wanted that.
I remember the one. I can't remember if it was a Samsung though. I think it was, but it was basically that sort of thing. But it was specifically about how they picked the exact shade of black they used. Yep. They went a deep dive on the black color they'd opted for that year. And it was like 3 minutes on why this black was the best black.
This is tangential, but I still love the Xiaomi logo redesign breakdown video.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. 15 minutes on that logo, and then they revealed
incredible
it, and it's like,
work.
Yeah, we rounded the corners, and the orange is one shade darker or something.
Yeah.
Unbelievable.
Great.
I've lost track of what we're actually talking about. Anyway, chips, Snapdragon HN1 or Exynos 2200. Basically, if you're in Europe or the UK, you get the Exynos. If you're not in Europe or the UK, you get the Snapdragon. That seems to be the split. It's pretty simple this time around. So, for example, Korea used to get Exynos, but Korea is getting Snapdragon this time around. So it really is just the UK and Europe getting Exynos. Funny is, this is the first year where, for a while, you always felt like you were like the red-headed stepchild getting an Exynos, you know, Samsung's, you know, unloved offspring. Last year, it felt like, doesn't matter too much. They're both pretty good. We're cool. This year, there's almost a little bit of a, I think we might have gotten the better chip. Benchmarks we've seen so far, the Exynos is at least with the HN1, if not better. Yeah. And it's got that AMD graphics tech.
I was going to say, graphically, I think
it benchmarks. Yeah,
on paper, it's better than the Snapdragon on graphics performance. In practice, we'll have to see. We don't know, but on paper.
Ray tracing, because you need that in your phone right now.
I mean, that's going to be big. You know, the thing is, who knows what games are going to support that? And again, Samsung are trapped here. They can't talk about it. They couldn't hype up ray tracing.
They didn't say
80% of the phones they're going to sell around the world won't support it. So strange little state, but yeah. So yeah, S22 series, I think these are really solid jumps. Oh, we haven't talked about camera, and we should talk about camera, because actually, to be fair, I think camera, they've made good progress here. And there are bigger changes to the S22 cameras than there are to the Ultra cameras, perversely.
Yeah, for sure.
Which is partly because maybe they had more catch-up work to do based on where the S21 cameras were, but still, big jumps. So basically, it's still got a triple rear camera, main camera ultra-wide, and a telephoto. But it's the main and the telephoto that have changed. The ultra-wide is, if it's not the same one, it's very similar. They are not talking about how much they've improved that. I think it might be the same camera, but I'm not 100%. Very, very similar, if not. Yeah. The other two have changed a lot, though. So the main camera has jumped from, I think it was 12 megapixel before.
Yeah.
It's now 50 megapixel. So it's a totally different sensor. Samsung were hyping up that it's bigger pixels. I think what they mean is after pixel binning,
sure,
it has bigger pixels.
That's the only way.
There's no way it has 50 megapixels versus 12, and each pixel is bigger than before, unless the sensor is 5 times the size or something.
According to this, the 50 meg sensor has 1 micron pixels, whereas the old 12 meg has 1.8 micron pixels. There you go.
Yes. So, but once they do Tetra binning, you then get more per bin
by
pixel.
Micron pixels, like pixels.
Anyway, this seems really solid. It's got OIS, it's got dual pixel autofocus, that kind of stuff that you'd expect. Toddy and I got to go and have a play around with the phones at Samsung Space in London, and this main camera seemed really impressive. I mean, it's always been good. It was good last year, but this definitely feels like, you know, enough of a step up to care about at a glance. You need to play around with it more and, you know, do full testing, but promising, I would say. Would you agree, Toddy?
Yeah, I've always, I'm just happy that they've actually put a proper telephoto as well on there.
Yes, so I was going to get to that after, but the telephoto is now a real 3x zoom telephoto rather than a 1.1 times high megapixel one.
Because the 12 meg lead sensor, they've had that for at least two generations now, maybe three. So I am intrigued to see, usually when a company changes sensor in a big way, like, it's always interesting to see how well they handle that transition. Like,
it needs a bit of breaking in.
Exactly.
A few updates.
OnePlus is the go-to brand for showing that challenge that can be faced when they move to new hardware like that. So once we get the phones in for review, it'd be interesting to see just how they compare.
Yeah.
And how well they've transitioned in terms of their image processing, their color, all that kind of stuff. But yeah.
Yeah. I like the look of it. I think the telephoto was significantly better from my brief play around as well. Again, last year's one was decent, and for a fake telephoto, it always gave better results than I expected it to. But this one, again, genuinely felt like, oh, this is a really good telephoto lens at that kind of 3x level and above.
I've always got a lot of love for, it seems to be 3x is the physical limit that most phones can do without adding periscope optics, which has a lot of weight and bulk and cost. So yeah, I think that's a good move rather than just repeating what they did last year. I'm glad that they forked out for something a little bit more optically powerful rather than relying more on the hardware and processing.
If nothing else, it just always felt a little bit misleading the way it was set up.
I think
before.
We wrote an op-ed about it.
We kind of complained about it being kind of this fake telephoto camera. I was never totally happy with it. And they did it 2 years in a row. I think it was both the 20s and the 21s had the same setup. So they would do a refresh on this camera setup. And I only got to play with the phone for an hour or so. And a lot of that was testing other stuff rather than just going through the camera and everything. But I think this is going to feel like a step up in the camera department for an S21. Yeah. I wouldn't say that and the glass are enough to like throw your S21 in the bin and buy a new phone. But if you were an S20 owner, for example, it's, you know, maybe enough to justify that two generation leap or something.
Can we briefly touch on the colors and the design as well? Like, do you guys, from the images you've seen, like, do you guys vibe the design? I mean, the S21 FE kind of set the tone for what the S22 range is offering, well, the 2 and the 2 plus, let's say. What do you guys think about the design tweaks? Do you even notice a difference, I guess?
Just I was about to say, I noticed there's a smaller camera on the rear, but aside from that, I'm just like, it's like, I don't notice, because I mean, I haven't followed it as closely as you two, of course. So I'm just going off what I remember the S21 range being like. But yeah, just off the top of my head, I'm like, it's the same phone. Maybe some new color options, but at a glance, it's not as identifiable as maybe they'd like.
I think it's quite a classic design. It's recognizable without being too standout and showy. But to me, it doesn't look particularly different, and I think that's probably a good thing. I don't think Samsung needs to start changing the camera design every year and trying to differentiate it constantly.
I think it there's an if it ain't broke, don't fix it thing, I think that look works for them, and they played around with the S design for a few years, and I've got to be honest, I've not always loved the way the S phones have looked, but I feel like this camera design is one of the first ones that they've settled on where I've been like, you know, I really like this, and it feels very distinctive. And I'm curious to see where they go with it next year, because this is the second year in a row they use this rough design. Android brands tend to do sort of couple years on a set design and then they reinvent it all over again. And it's interesting because, of course, Apple doesn't do that. Apple, you know, uses a design till they've worn it out and doesn't move on until they really feel that they need to. And I do wonder, and I don't mean that as a criticism, because I do wonder if there's a benefit to Samsung kind of saying, hey, this is what a Samsung S phone looks like. You know, it should look like this, and we can keep it looking like that so that people see it and know what it is. And there's an appeal to that that I feel like the Android side has always has never fully appreciated that brand identity side to the hardware itself. So I would be, say, very happy if the next two generations of S phones looked roughly like that.
I kind of get what you mean, because I mean, not to detract from the Samsung side of things, but like I'm happy with the iPhone design as it is now. Like I'm just like, yeah, I could take that for the next couple of years.
I'm all for a design change every now and then, but you don't need to do it every year. Yeah. And if you've got one that works so that people can recognize and see one and go, it's a Samsung phone. Like, good, cool.
Yeah, I think it was probably the S21 FE that kind of kicked off this mild shift in the design, because obviously all the fundamental elements are still there. But it is probably taking a leaf out of Apple's book by going a bit more slab-sided, like you saw with the Vivo V23 series, Dom, as well.
Yep.
Which is better for their designs. I would imagine it makes things easier and cheaper to develop, because you don't have to worry about rounding the edges so much. You've got slightly more room to play with in a very small space that you're already working with.
Well, I've got to say, I really like as well what Samsung has done here, which is a compromise position where I think they've acknowledged that industry trend, which is people have looked at Apple going back to the straight edges with the iPhone 12, and a lot of people are kind of like, yeah, cool. You know, the wind's blowing that way, I guess.
Let's do that.
But what they've done here is the front and back are flat. You know, there's no curved display or anything, but the sides are slightly rounded. They're not totally straight edged, which also means you don't get those corners. Like the iPhone has corners on the edge that I'll admit I'm not a fan of. I think they diminish the hand feel and the comfort, especially if you're holding it for a long time. This is just a little bit rounded on the sides, which makes it a lot more comfortable to hold to me, but you've still got that simplicity of the flat back. It doesn't look or feel like one of those totally rounded wraparound phones that were all the rage 4 years ago.
In terms of the if it ain't broke, don't fix it design approach, I feel like the colors is an admission that last year's signature Phantom Violet, I think it was called, was the wrong lead color, because you can technically get the S22 and Plus in that color again with a gold frame, gold camera, and a violet purple back. But it is an online only exclusive color that no one mentioned in the launch or anywhere.
All I don't know about my frustration with that one all along was the purple's great.
Yeah,
purple's the contrast good. In gold is gold horrible.
Oh yeah,
where was that man in that room at Samsung HQ? He should have
swapped
out
for a silver. Silver would be an improvement on that.
Silver and purple, because you know the S21 FE purple was one of the lead colors, and I reviewed the FE in purple and beautiful, and I think the shade of purple really they have for the 22 is still really nice. I don't want it with a gold camera. It's a horrible combination.
Really weird.
The colors they have this year are nice. I think having seen all four of the base S22 finishes in person, for me the winners are the graphite or black, which is a little bit off black, and actually I normally get bored by black phones, but I think they've done a good job with it.
And the green contrast of the finish is what helps it,
because it's slightly off. It's not but the dark green is lovely. Really lovely. That's definitely the winner for sure. But I like all the colors. I've only seen the core colors, those online exclusives Samsung didn't tell us about in advance, and we haven't seen them in person, so I don't know. But you know, from looking online,
sky blue looks nice. That has like a silver frame and silver camera, which is quite strange.
It looks kind of like the same cream as the Flip. I think it's a similar color finish to the Flip,
but with the silver frame, I don't know if that works as well. And it's the same, they have a light blue, a sky blue, I think they call it, which again is a silver frame, so they're not really color matching like they are with the main colors between the frame and the glass back. But yeah,
I've got to say, the range of online exclusive colors and the different contrasting camera module colors, to me, is more evidence for my long-held pet theory that they are going to do S22 Bespoke Edition. And that in a month or two's time, they're going to announce, hey, if you're willing to spend an extra $50, you can pick what color the back is and pick what color the camera module is. Because that's what they did with the Z Flip. And you know what? The Z Flip was the only other one they've done where they announced a range of colors and then an extensive range of online-only colors with different contrasting camera modules. And lo and behold, a month later, they let you mix and match. Yeah. So
they did.
I now feel quite confident we're going to get that for this.
Cool. So tune into episode 120, where we'll talk about the different extra new colors you can get.
Yeah. You might as well, you know, they've got this whole thing, colored, you know, different colors of camera model and everything, and they're clearly building them in all sorts of different combos. So, why not?
They've clearly got the means to assemble them. Can you?
Exactly. It's another Samsung USP, right?
I just wonder about the environmentals of that. Like, is it wasteful?
But Toddy, they don't put a charger in the box.
Oh yeah,
they've solved the environmental problems. Balances
it all out. That's fine.
fixed nature. That's cool.
And I don't know, some small bit of the phone is made from fishing net plastic.
Oh yeah, yeah, true.
Yeah.
Is that just the Ultra though? I wasn't sure if that was the other phone.
I'm not even sure which bit of the phone it was. They were saying is
but cool.
From that. Yeah.
Thanks. Guys.
Let's talk about the Ultra because we've gone about the regular phones for a while now. The Ultra is a funny one because it is very different to the other phones, and it is the it's the argument against my suggestion that Samsung is developing a distinctive S series design that it could stick with for a few years. Because hey, there's another S phone right now with a completely different design that just ruins that. But it looks very different to the others. It's got unique features in that it's got the stylus, the S Pen support, including a slot in the phone for it to go into. But in a funny way, it's had fewer upgrades relative to last year's phone.
Yeah,
compared to, you know, the camera is upgraded, and we'll get to that, but it's not as upgraded as the other one has. It hasn't had the big shift from plastic to glass or anything like that. You know, a lot of the build material and a lot of the specs have stayed basically the same year on year. So all the changes are really the note stuff. And the funny thing about that is, of course, that's them just taking features and design from a phone that came out a year and a half ago. So the biggest changes they have are a year and a half old. In a strange little way. Toddy, you spent a lot more time with the Ultra than I did. I kind of played with it briefly, but my focus was on the base models and yours on the Ultra.
Yeah.
So, and yeah, you were there. You've used the Note 20 Ultra. You've got more, you know, you've used a lot of the Ultras more than I have, to be honest.
Yeah.
Where does this one sit in the line for you? How do you feel about it overall?
I mean, in terms of the design sticks out like a sore thumb against the rest of the range because it is the Note's design, the Note 20 Ultra's design in terms of body. So it's flat top and bottom, kind of a pill-shaped profile, very aggressively rounded back and
very rounded, with a
thin frame, which the main difference, I think, coming from the Note is that was a 6.9-inch screen. This is a 6.8-inch screen. I think that tiny adjustment does give it a really, really nice hand feel that the Note was just that. It was just too big. It was huge to use because of the aspect ratio. It was a lot wider than the S21 Ultra, which had also a 6.8-inch screen, but it's a taller, thinner footprint. Mm. So I think by making the screen a bit smaller but keeping the Note aspect ratio, I think they've got a really nice balance there by going for the same Note design. I think that was the right call. If they do change the design for the regular S phones, say next year or the year after, I'm wondering whether the new camera implementation on the back of the S22 Ultra is where things are going. Getting rid of the contour cut.
I hope not.
Yeah, I hope not too. I don't mind it, but it's nowhere near as distinct. I quite liked the S21 Ultra's big camera island. It was ridiculous.
Yeah.
Bombastic, but I kind of love that.
I'm in the funny position. I like both of these camera designs. And I don't know which one I prefer. Probably slightly the contour cut, but I really do like them both.
Yeah.
But I just wish Samsung had picked one of them. You know, it's maybe a silly thing for me as an outsider to worry about, but I just really wish these phones were consistent. I wish they all had... I could handle the fact that the sides of the body are going to be a bit different and everything, but man, why can't they all have matching cameras? So they
just
look
give it
like
one characteristic so you know they're part of the same family. Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Mm. It just makes sense. You know, if you weren't following along the rumors, at one point it was going to be the Galaxy... Was it S22
Note?
Was, and that is the correct name for this phone as far as I can see.
Yeah.
I mean, you can only assume, you know, I know a lot of people have kind of questioned why didn't they go with that? And I'm not saying this is necessarily like, you know, proof they did the right thing, but they must have just focus tested the hell out of that choice and gone through loads of market research of like different groups of how do you react to these two names? Yeah. And my best guess would be that maybe they found people got confused about, well, is it a Note or is it an S? What is it? Whereas Ultra just, it marks it as being an S, and it also immediately tells you this is the best one, the biggest one, the most expensive. This is the top spec, which is obviously what they want to sell you on.
In the consumer base who knows about Samsung's phones already, I feel like Galaxy Note has more power than Ultra.
Yeah.
But then to users who just want the best Samsung phone that don't really look into specs or the lineage, Ultra just sounds better. So maybe that was how they took it.
Yeah.
And also, I wonder if it locks you off a bit, because if you call it Ultra, right, you can win over people who maybe don't care about the S Pen. They don't hate it. They're happy to have it there, but they're not fussed about it, which, for example, I don't... It's cool that it's there. I would never really use my phone extensively with a stylus. But, you know, if I was like, well, I want the Samsung phone with the best camera, so I want to buy the Ultra. But if you tell people it's the Note, they're just maybe more likely to go, oh, I don't want a stylus. That one's not for me. I'll move on. what this is a stylus phone and I don't want a stylus, so I'll look elsewhere. But if you just say it's the Ultra, it's the best one. Cool.
Yeah. So yeah, I don't mind the design. Again, there's it has a black, a white, a green, same green as the S22s. The burgundy is their signature color this year, which is kind of like the Mystic Silver from the Note 20 Ultra, but a bit darker. I quite like it. I think it looks
good. I don't love it.
You don't love it?
I don't like the burgundy.
The online colors are weird because they almost all, I think, have a black frame regardless of the color. And then you just get, there's red, which looks kind of like a burnt orange. I think there's a blue, and then there's another color that I forget what it is.
Yeah, I think the sky blue is there again. I can't remember what it is. Yeah.
But with a black frame, which is quite unusual. Yeah. But yeah, so the design is fine because I didn't mind the Note 20 Ultra's design. This is a smaller, more pocketable version of that, so I'm okay with it. And the aspect ratio means it's better for certain things that I think the stylus facilitates.
Yeah.
Beyond that, specs are very similar to the rest of the range, same chip options. The big shift I'd say is that it starts at 8 gigs of RAM, whereas last year's Ultra started at 12, and there was only a 12 all the way up. It was just storage that you changed. But at the same time, you also get at the top end up to a terabyte now, which they've never, I don't think they've ever gone that high with the Galaxy S phone.
Yeah. To put that in perspective, on the other two phones, you can get eight gigs of RAM fixed on the other two phones and a choice of 128 or 256 storage. That's it. Ultra is 8 and 128 or 12 gigs of RAM and 256 or 512 or a terabyte. So as soon as you up the storage, the RAM goes up. So the people who really care about that will go up. I guess they, again, probably market research, whatever, came to the conclusion that the people who want more RAM are also the people who want more storage and, you know, cater them and also recognize that a lot of people at the lower end don't care and RAM is not going to be a selling point for them.
If they probably just want sense, the phone to have the phone. Yeah. Like,
it is a little bit of frustration. And it's a funny one because we didn't really talk about pricing too much, but with the other S22s, the base pricing basically has stayed the same in all these phones. And for the S22 and the Plus, that feels quite impressive. They've added a decent amount, not flashy updates, but decent spec upgrades year on year, including that shift to glass, which could normally be a big price driver. And they've kept the prices the same. And you look at that and say, hey, fair play. That makes these make a lot of sense. But then the Ultra is kind of the opposite. It's like, well, they haven't changed that much. They've actually lowered the RAM and they're charging the same price. Mm. And you begin to look and say, oh, well, the Ultra doesn't feel very
nice. Cheaper
priced.
If you compare it to the Note when that launched by a little bit, but not by much.
And I think even at some of the higher storage options, it actually is more expensive for less than some of last year's models.
Interesting.
So the pricing on the Ultra is a little bit funny.
Yeah.
I still think, as much as anything, all of the pricing they pick is about just setting their range. It's about setting jumps between from the S22 to the S22 Plus to the Ultra to the Fold. And that's part of why the Plus is $200 more than the regular. It's not because it costs Samsung $200 more to make it or because they think it's got $200 of upgrades. It's because there's a $400 gap between the regular one and the Ultra. And so they want the Plus to sit halfway between, you know, they just want it in the middle.
And to that point, like making the Fold look good, like the fact it's like in the same ballpark as their other phones, like the higher you make the regular candy bar phones, the more impressive the saving looks.
Yes, the Ultra needs to get a bit close to the Fold
psychological.
To make it all work. So I see how they get there. But there are some little bits that are annoying. You get high resolution display on the Ultra, which you might expect. It's FHD plus on the others and QHD on this.
Yeah.
Biggest battery, 5,000 milliamp hours. It's bigger than any of the others, but it's the same charging as the Plus, 45 watts.
Yeah.
25 watt wireless. You do get the Wi-Fi 6E and the ultra wideband on this one, in case you care. I guess that just leaves a camera to talk about. And it's another funny one where, even more so than also the S22 has some reasonable spec changes. This one, the Ultra, if you look on paper and compare the specs here to last year's S21 Ultra specs, it looks like the same camera setup. And in fairness to Samsung, it isn't. But man, on paper, it's the same. It's 108 megapixel main.
Physically looks the same. At the lenses and like the laser bit, they look the same. They've just taken away the contour cut bit around it.
So it's 108 megapixel main camera, 12 megapixel ultra wide, and then dual 10 megapixel telephotos, one at 3x, one at 10x. That is the same setup they had before. I think, again, the ultra wide is the same. same as with the regulars. I do think they have not changed the ultra wide, or at least they haven't changed it dramatically. The others have changed a bit. The main camera is a different sensor. It is a larger sensor than the one they used before. So it's the same megapixel count. I think they've even set it with the same aperture lens. So, you know, on paper, again, looks very much the same. But it is a different sensor. It's a bigger sensor. It's a better sensor. Should be, you know, superior at low light and stuff like that. And I think they've also tweaked the telephotos hardware-wise, but they're a bit vaguer about what they've changed there.
Yeah, I'm using GSM Marina's spec sheet because they usually dive a little deeper than Samsung's willing to tell. So apparently the sensors in both the telephotos are physically larger sensors. So they have slightly smaller pixel sizes.
Overall.
And so the apertures stay the same. But the focal lengths change a tiny bit by about 10 mil on each. And yeah, the sensors are physically larger. I think that's the main difference.
Yeah. So basically it seems like they've kept the lenses basically the same, but upgraded a few of the sensors.
Minor. Yeah.
So yeah, the main camera I think was always very good. It still seemed very good. I think the thing that I don't want to speak for Toddy too much, but we were both really impressed. This is going to sound strange to say, but we were both really impressed by Space Zoom. And I think we normally make fun of all that high zoom stuff, but we took a 30 time zoom shot of, Toddy took a 30 time zoom shot of me, and the quality on how it captured my face was fantastic.
Because we tested it on a leaf first on a plant over the way, and it looked like it smoothed it to kingdom come. And we were like, oh, that's terrible still. What's the point? But then maybe it's got algorithm specifics, like specifics for faces or something. But yeah, when Dom said like a ways away and we did a zoom shot, it was impressive. Like the frame of your glasses and stuff, it retained all of that, which I wasn't expecting at that point.
Very sharp. Yeah. A lot of detail, really crisp for 30 times zoom. So
it'd be cool to play with that some more because it was impressive.
So I do think they've made big improvements on the zoom performance, which
like it's usable now. With. Like actually has value.
Finally, just it's only taken about 3 years.
But hey, it can do it, so that's cool.
There we go. We got there in the end.
Does it still go all the way up to 100 times?
Yeah,
it
but
does.
Just a terrible quality. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. That, I wouldn't use that still, but like,
there's still very rarely going to be for that.
Like a spec sheet feature banner thing to say it's got
ticking a box,
times.
Ticking a marketing box.
Yeah. I haven't yet seen a phone with 100 times zoom that's actually worth using. But not
the other big like software feature they were hyping up is one that I still don't fully understand and want to get more time playing with the phones to figure out how they think it, where it's meant to kick in. The tech they're calling adaptive pixel, which basically combines a full resolution shot from the main camera, so either the 50 megapixel or the 100 and 108 megapixel, depending on the regular or the ultra phones. It combines that to get the detail from that with a pixel bin shot from the same lens, which gives you the better brightness and light information and stuff like
that. Noise.
And less noise. That, what's not clear on that is I think the resulting shot you get from that is a full resolution shot. I.e., what you get from that is a 108 megapixel shot out of the ultra.
I assumed it was going to go the other way and be binned at the end.
When I was playing around with the camera, I was struggling with it, but it seemed to me that when you turned that on, well, that was a way of turning on, like, it's turning on the high resolution mode. But it had sort of slightly conflicting information on this from people in Samsung I've spoken to. And I didn't have enough time with the phone to really get to the bottom of figuring out because I couldn't delve into the files to figure out what they were doing. So I'm a little unsure about this because if it's using it to improve regular photos, great. If it's just to make the super high resolution shots better, then that's cool, but no one really uses that.
Other camera features I liked was the auto FPS thing is terrible if you want to edit video in any serious way, but it improves low light video by reducing the frame rate automatically and dynamically, which is smart. And they had face tracking that does like Apple center stage tech where it kind of crops in and crops out automatically, which is nice. That was the only other thing I was going to say on the cameras.
I was just going to say, because it's really interesting that you should talk about this now, because I remember probably about 9 months ago, there was a prediction about the iPhone, the next gen iPhones, and there was talk saying they would be able to take 48 megapixel and 12 megapixel pictures at the same time, but nobody could work out why. So I feel like this might be
I think it's basically the same thing. And so the Samsung pitch is that you're combining the detail you get from the full res with the light information and the color information you get from pixel binning.
It's one of those features though that unless I can turn it on and off, I can't I don't know whether it's really actually any better.
Exactly. So that's why I'm hesitant, because I'm not entirely sure what it's doing when it kicks in. And you need to turn it on and off, take photos on every, you know, the same shot all the different ways and figure out which one is coming out well. But from what I understand of what it's doing, it seems to basically be a way of making full res shots better than they were before, which is cool. But how many people use full res shots, especially say on the Ultra with 108 megapixels? No one actually needs these 108 megapixels.
If you've got the 1 terabyte hard drive and storage to go with it.
Sure, I guess so.
We've spent all this time talking about the phones, and we really should turn to the tabs, because there is enough interesting stuff to talk about the tablets as well. So, three tablets. I think we will probably rattle through the base ones quickly, because like with the S22s, the base ones they're not that exciting. And I don't want to poo-poo them too much, because I think I actually was like using the regular S8 at the launch event. I was like, I kind of want one of these. This is, you know, that size, a really lovely tablet. But they're not radically interesting tablets. They've had spec bumps, a little bit of polish, slight redesign, but nothing crazy. But the Tab S8 Ultra is a bit weird. And if you haven't seen it yet, go check out on our YouTube channel. We have a video on the Tech Advisor channel by one of our colleagues in the US, a guy called Mark, who basically makes a pitch that I'll admit it hadn't really occurred to me as what they're going for, but he makes a pitch that the Tab S8 Ultra is a laptop replacement. And that's where Samsung is positioning this tablet, because it's got a 14.5-inch display. Ooh. And it's in a widescreen. It's in a 16:10 aspect ratio.
It's really wide.
So like actually, if you set it landscape, you're actually kind of like, oh, that's a laptop display.
TV.
And if you use the, you know, they don't sell it with the keyboard cover, but if you buy a keyboard cover, then, you know, they make an official one, obviously. You've got a keyboard, and actually the official one they do has even like glass trackpad and stuff. So it's a nice keyboard cover and trackpad setup. I had, you know, played around with it. It was pretty decent. It's not a laptop keyboard, but it's not so far off. Samsung has its DeX mode, which creates a kind of, you know, Windows style environment. And of course, the funny thing is you've got really, really good webcams, better than any webcams in a laptop, because the front facing cameras are great on this. Part of the problem, and there is a notch. And those cameras are in a notch, and Samsung has spent so long making fun of the iPhone notch, and now they've gone and put out their like $1,000+ tablet with the bloody notch on it. And I think
the iPads don't have the notch either, so they've really shot themselves in the foot here.
It's also strange, because obviously, you know, it's good to have good front-facing cameras on a tablet, but do they need to be so good that they can't fit in your bezel? Like, surely you could have slightly worse front-facing cameras and everyone would still be like, they're good, they're better than a webcam.
The MacBook is like 1 meg usually or something like that,
just a pixel.
I guess my only theory on that would be that since loads of other Android phone manufacturers started releasing tablets, that Samsung has decided, right, suddenly ours all looks the same as all the other Android tablets out there. How are we going to make it stand out, and also compared to the regular Tab S8 and S8 Plus? Well, this one's got a notch and it's huge. Look how different it is. Because I'm guessing that's the only one that's going to be a realistic laptop replacement.
I mean, in the Android tablet space, I feel like they had the S7 FE last year, but like, is it 2020, the S7 range launch? I think that sounds right.
Yeah, it was towards the end of 2020.
They were still probably the best Android tablets money could buy in terms of what I'd recommend people if you really wanted a good Android tablet. Like even like right up until now, pretty much.
Yeah.
So they were only really competing with themselves with the Tab S8 series. So maybe that's why the standard models are not the most exciting, but then they needed the Ultra to kind of hype up the range, because it's like, look at all this stuff that the Ultra can do, because the other two models are just incremental, because they don't need to be anything more than that.
And of course, the funny thing is, it's the other models that have the competition. You know, there are other Android manufacturers coming into the tablet space, but so far, at least, none of them are doing $1,200 tablets.
No.
You know, that's still the space that it's only Samsung and obviously iPad Pros on the other side. So, but if the Ultra hype, like Tony said, it hypes up the range, builds up enthusiasm for the idea of Tab S8s are cool. It makes those cheaper ones, and I said cheaper, they're not cheap, they're, you know, $700 for the base one, but it makes them maybe feel a bit more exciting and appealing, even though they're not unexciting, but like I said at the beginning, conservative. They're conservative updates. They're not rocking the boat.
I feel like they're definitely still primarily like tablets for entertainment. for consuming content consumption over productivity. Because there aren't many changes, and I reviewed the Tab S7 Plus, and it's great if you want to watch YouTube or Netflix or listen to music or whatever, but when you actually try and get work done, it just kind of, particularly from the software side, it kind of lets itself down a bit. So that would be the real interesting thing with the Ultra, if it can bridge that gap and make the software really compelling for productivity.
I think for me, one of the more exciting announcements on the tablet side of things was the LumaFusion partnership, because LumaFusion on the iPad is hands down the best video editing app that you can get on the iPad. So the fact that's going to be coming to the tabs and it's in a Samsung exclusive is a real like, oh, hello, this is intriguing, because that will be the first kind of desktop level kind of thing that you can get on the Android side, as far as I can think. None of the others are really popping up in mind.
I mean, Android tablets, it's always been like, you know, Samsung's made great tablets for a while now in the Android space, but the software has always let it down. The third-party support especially.
Yeah.
So it's really on basically Samsung, because no one else seems to be pulling their weight in that regard, working with app developers to be like, look, please optimize for the Android tablet experience. And part of that is Google's responsibility, and that's what Android L might support as well.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But yeah, it's I can't imagine it's easy to hype up your features on an Android tablet when the infrastructure around it that isn't within your control easily is so poor. Which Apple addressed really early on with the iPad range, and it's just
exactly
been good stead ever since.
And Samsung have been fighting a losing battle there, because they are the only people doing it. So you know, if you're trying to persuade the software developers to do pro level Android tablet software, you know, when you're trying to persuade them to do that for phones, you're like, look, here's this whole rich marketplace of high-end phones, make games that run well on these, because look, you can get rich doing this. When you're saying it for like make high-end productivity creative software for Android tablets, it's like, look, do this because we Samsung make them. And it's like, there must be a great Google Pixel tablet. No, not really. You know, surely Xiaomi and Oppo and Huawei are all making like high-end one. It's like, well, Huawei kind of are, but they're doing their own thing now anyway. And now Oppo might be working on one, but there's nothing out. And Xiaomi make a cheap one, but it won't run productivity tasks, and it doesn't come with a stylus in the West. And you know, it's sort of like
Realme's got one that they're not going to update with software.
So if you're someone like Adobe trying to be persuaded to pour you know, millions into software R&D to optimize for Android, you just be like, well, why? There's only 5 users. It's just not worth it. The marketplace isn't there. And they're always, you know, it's always going to be that challenge. And I guess it's chicken and egg kind of thing, right? You know, you can't get the hardware without software, and you can't get the software without the hardware, but Samsung is kind of doggedly pushing it with the hardware, and perversely they probably have to hope that they start getting more competition in the hardware space, because without it they're never going to get the software support they want.
I think the Ultra feels, I mean, I know they're trying to tie the range together, but if they want to push that specifically as like the productivity one and the one that's going to do all the heavy lifting and stuff, I don't think that 16:10 aspect ratio was the right call. It's great for media.
It's a really funny one, especially when you put it in the context of the laptop replacement discussion. Because in laptops, the move towards productivity is towards squarer.
I always think about the surface and
displays.
They're like, 3x2.
By two is what everyone loves. And we're moving away from 16:9 and 16:10 to go to 3x2. So then you put out this 16:10 tablet and say, oh, it's great for productivity. And you go, well, hang on, why? Why is widescreen better for productivity when everyone else in the market says the opposite? And it's obviously, it's you look at it and you pick it up and you're like, you know, it's a huge tablet. It's absolutely enormous. But you pick it up and you're just like, I want to watch Netflix on this thing. Like, I want to, but I don't want to spend $1,200 for the tablet I'm going to watch in bed. But equally, you're like, I want to watch Netflix on this. This is the best tablet in the world, probably, for watching Netflix on. But
I completely understand where you're coming from that, because the iPad, the top end 12.9 inch iPad Pro, it's basically square. And no matter, I know it's got, you know, a gorgeously 120Hz refresh rate, you know, beautiful resolution. I will not watch stuff on it, because I hate the massive spaces above and below on videos. And it's just, so I feel like there is something that I think they just need to work out what this device is for, because I feel like they're like, we want it for both.
That's it. I don't know who this is for, because we had this, we've got this video saying this could be a good laptop replacement, and I can see that. But equally, I think, well, if you're not looking at it as a laptop replacement, then it feels like it's built for entertainment. but it's too expensive to be an entertainment tablet. No one drops a grand on entertainment tablets.
Yeah.
It seems to be positioned as an iPad Pro rival for creativity, and it's got the S Pen support and all of that. And, you know, high-end specs and everything, go up to 16 gig of RAM and all of that.
Wow.
But then you say, well, why has it got a notch and why is it 16 by 10? Because I can't imagine that's an obvious pitch for creatives.
And I don't know if this is true in other markets, but like they also paired it in the UK with all of the products they announced, basically, with 12 months of Disney Plus access.
Yes.
No Microsoft Office 365 access or anything like that. Adobe Apps access. Mm. Entertainment,
of course.
So it's a weird one. I mean, Toddy made the point that you could see the without support and everything, you could see the pitch of using creative apps on this, where you can actually say pull like swatch tools and stuff to columns on the side, and have a kind of 3x2 workspace, but have tools and swatches that's alongside it in a way that maybe is often more cramped on other tablets. And that can work. And obviously there's multitasking. They're big on how good it is for multitasking. And you could just carve off one column of your window for Slack and the rest of it for whatever you're working on and that kind of thing. But I still feel like I don't know who they think is going to buy the Ultra. But equally, it's lovely. I don't want to downplay it. I want one. I really want
one. Yeah, they're really nice.
I wouldn't spend $1,200 on it. But it's lovely and it's super thin and lightweight for what it is. You know, the build quality is wow.
I'd maybe say just to people, like, if they want a nice Samsung tablet, maybe now is the best time to buy an S7, Tab S7.
Yeah.
Because I don't think there's anything...
Or give it a week or two for the price to start their free fall. But,
I can't think what the Tab S8 range is bringing right now. Obviously, the future-proofing of software and performance, yes. And tablets last longer than phones usually anyway, so that makes sense.
Yeah.
But I feel like there's still so much that the Tab S7 range can offer, and it's going to get so much cheaper. Like,
that's a good question. Yeah. And Niren, do you have a good sense, setting the Ultra aside, I guess, because there wasn't one before, but do you have a clear sense of what the jump is from an S7 to an S8? Obviously, you've got the chipset change to an 8.1.
I mean, the chipset change, because it is like the kind of two generations, it'll be a bit more significant.
Yeah. Sure.
Of course, because it was an 865.
Yeah.
Right.
So that's a bigger jump. And that's really the main one. I was kind of comparing them earlier, and there really isn't a huge amount. Most of the difference is between the two models. Because, I mean, they've still got 120 hertz on both of them. They're still the same screen sizes. They did have 4G models of the Tab S7, and they're also obviously all 5G now.
Right. Or Wi-Fi only, to be clear. There's still Wi-Fi only ones if you want it. Yeah.
For the cellular. And then like it's still like the base Tab S8 is still LCD, and then it's OLED on the S8 Plus. But the big differences are between the two models. If you're comparing the equivalent model of the Tab S7 series, there isn't really enough upgrades to kind of justify it, especially if you already own an S7 or S7 Plus.
Yeah, I mean, I can't see the jump. For an existing S7 owner, there's not enough here to move you along, unless the Ultra is what's caught your eye.
Oh, latency is that only other thing. Like, S Pen latency is better on this generation. It was 9 on both the Note 20 Ultra and the Tab S7 range. It's 6.2 on the Tab S8 range and 2.8 on the S22 Ultra, excuse me.
Mm-hmm.
So it's faster, but it was already like 9 was already really good. I think it was 2.8 about the same as the Apple Pencil. Yeah, mental, right?
That's crazy.
So I think it now is technically more responsive than an Apple Pencil. The problem is there's no apps. So
yeah,
what are you gonna do with
Samsung Notes? It's really good at Samsung Notes now. So that paper like response.
Yeah, the Huawei MatePad was really good on the Notes app as well.
One couple quick clarification points, probably worth saying. We did mention chips, but I'm pretty sure all the S8s are Snapdragon 8 Gen 1s worldwide.
Yeah,
certainly they are for the UK, whereas the phones are Exynos in the UK. So I think it's 8 Gen 1s everywhere. So there's no Exynos version of the tablets as far as we're aware. And the other thing to clarify again, especially when we were talking about the S7s as a comparison point, is the S8s are covered, the Tab S8s are covered by that same up to 4 years of Android versions and 5 years of security updates. And while they've backdated that to the S21 phones, they haven't backdated that to the Tab S7s.
Right.
So actually, even a Tab S,
in the, as sorry, far as I'm aware, the FE.
I don't know about the S7 FE, but yeah. No, sorry, they definitely haven't. That promise is not back to the S7 FE. That right. 4 years of 4 years Android versions is all the S21s, all the S22s, Z Fold 3, Z Flip 3, all the Tab S8s. So I can't remember what the update promise for the Tab S7 would have been. You'll be able to find that online somewhere, probably either 2 or 3 years of version update. So that, if that was 2 years, the Tab S7 could be about to get its, that would have launched with 10, I would guess. Mm-hmm. It yeah. could have just gotten 12, and maybe 12 is the last update it gets, or maybe it gets 13.
I think whereas, it was 2019. They were like, Samsung was like, any devices in 2019 get the 3 years of OS.
Right. So it and might go to 13 next year.
You might do.
But
yeah.
the S8 is going to get 12, then 13, 14, 15, 16. Wow. So the software update difference now pretty between cool. an S8 and an S7 is massive. Mm. And I think that matters more here because I think, well,
oh, yeah.
a lot of people buy a phone and we all like the idea that people should buy phones and use them for longer. But a lot of people still buy a phone and replace it in 2 years because of contracts and stuff like that. Yeah. But for tablets, I think people want their tablet to last them 5 years.
Yeah.
And you know what? You're going to get 4 or 5 years of software updates here. The Tab S7, from now on, you're only getting another year or two, which is a big difference, I think.
My iPad Air 2 is still going strong.
Yeah, right.
Yeah. Yeah, my answer
is so tablets, just you expect longevity, and to be honest, you can usually get it. So, because it's, yeah. you know, it's normally sitting at home, sometimes in a rucksack, it's not getting carried around all day, every day. The usage isn't the same. So, yeah, for me, I think that and the two generations of chipset difference,
yeah,
I would still say it's the 8 looks worth it rather than necessarily rushing for a cheap 7 now that the prices are going down. But, you know, depends what you're looking for, I guess.
Mm. It's worth noting we are expecting at some point later in the year there will be an S8 FE, which will kind of be pitched at that lower level. I mean, that's still kind of around the £500-600 mark, so it's not cheap. Yeah. But it's an affordable alternative that hopefully yeah. will still have the 8 Gen 1 and a few other premium features.
Exactly. Yeah. And to be fair, maybe the sweet spot now is the S7 FE, which is, more recent than the S7s. Get the software updates for a little bit longer, not quite as long as this, but a bit closer.
Yeah, I also need to look at what the jump is between the A8 that they launched. It was announced end of last year, and I think it hit the market, at least in the West, very start of this year. As their kind of iPad 10.2, like standard iPad rival, I guess is what I would perceive that as.
Yeah.
So it'd be just interesting to see like where they all kind of slot together. iPad.
It'll probably be an iPad Air rival.
Yeah, that feels right.
Because that's around the £500 mark.
Right.
Yeah, I've not closely looked at the A8. My feeling is the A8 is probably going to be close enough to the Xiaomi Pad 4, I think it was. 5? I can't remember. The one, like, yeah, 5, which, was late last year, and I feel like if they're similar prices, I'll bet you any money the Xiaomi is better spec'd, because the Xiaomi was very solidly spec'd for its price. Yeah. So I suspect if you were into that cheaper range, actually I'd probably point someone towards the Xiaomi, unless they really wanted the stylus support or something like that. But I don't know the Tab A8 very well, so I don't want to speak too.
Yeah. I mean, Xiaomi does a pen, it just wasn't in the West. I think in China.
Yes, the weird thing is you could probably order it online and get it shipped from China, because there is a stylus for the Xiaomi pads and it should work. It just, they didn't release it in the West. So
yeah, and a keyboard.
Yes, and a keyboard. I would quite like the stylus. I was a bit annoyed when the stylus didn't come out of here. But anyway. Right. I think that'll probably do us for today. Having only talked about 2 launches essentially, but 6 products. Big week for Samsung. We're going to be getting all of these in, we hope, sometime soon. So we'll probably be talking about some of these more on the show as we get the chance to actually test them out for a bit longer and come back with some review thoughts. But there's obviously a lot coming up over the next few weeks. So I have a feeling we're going to be a little bit busy. Yes. As I said, next week, I know for sure we have the Redmi K50 Gaming Edition launch, the Realme 9 Pro and Pro Plus launch, the OnePlus Nord CE 2 launch, and the Nubia Red Magic 7 launch. All next Wednesday and Thursday, all I think before next.
Not
Thursday
even the
show.
Whole week, it's 2 days.
That's not even the whole week, that's just 2 days. So, you know, next week's show will be us talking about some combination of those phones.
Is NWC going to be the break? Is that going to be the
break?
Yeah,
NWC will be a quiet week off in Barcelona. Yeah. Run out of stuff to announce. We'll all get a bit of sun. It'd be very nice. But yeah, we're going to be back this time next week to talk about some of those launches. So there should be some exciting stuff to chat over next week. I'm particularly curious to see what the Nubia Red Magic 7 has to offer, because they always go a bit nuts with those and throw some crazy specs out there. So if we thought Samsung's like thermals deep dive was impressive, then wait till
get ready.
Spend 20 buckle minutes up talking about fan blades.
Yeah, it's almost as bad as Asus. Really deep in that stuff.
But yes, this has been Fast Charge. We've been the team at Tech Advisor, so do check out. We have some more videos on the Tech Advisor YouTube channel about the Samsung stuff. I've already mentioned that Tab S8 Ultra video. Also, Toddy has done a little hands-on piece with the S22 Ultra, talking about how it compares to the rest of the Note line. And I have also taken the base S22 and stacked it up against last month's S21 FE to see exactly how they compare, considering how close they are in price. Spoiler alert, the S22 does win that. Probably won't be too surprised.
What?
But yeah, thank you to everyone who's been watching and listening. We will be back next week, so we'll see you all soon. And yeah, thanks to everyone who's joined me on the show this week. Bye, guys.
Bye.
Bye. Bye.